I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Anita Borg Institute for this honor. Anita Borg has left a tremendous legacy, and I'm very proud to be part of it. I was selected for the category of innovation, and if I were asked to name one part of my research that I would call the most innovative, it would be the thread of research on text summarization that led to the development of NewsBlaster, which was mentioned in the video. In thinking back to how this came about, I remember the first proposal I wrote on summarization and submitted to NSF in about 1993. This was the time that it occurred to me that the field of natural language was ripe for developing a system that could take text as input and produce a paragraph summary as output. No one else was working on it, and I wanted to be first to get results in this area. But the grant was rejected. Reviewers said, too ambitious, unrealistic, among other things. I was disappointed, but I wasn't about to take no as an answer. I was too excited about it. A new student who entered the PhD program at that time was just as excited as I was, and I figured out a way that we could work on it without the NSF funding. We raced to get a system working, and we published our first paper on summarization in 1995 at SIGIR, the major conference on information retrieval. This was the first in a series of dissertations from our group that focused on different kinds of news summarizations and ultimately resulted in NewsBlaster. And I note that following the 1995 paper, we were funded many times on text summarization by both NSF and DARPA. Not taking no for an answer has been part of my life from the beginning. I heard no many times, but saw that it didn't always have to happen that way. It was good training for the realities of research. As a young girl interested in math, I heard no and became more determined than ever. In high school, I was in the advanced math class, and I decided to apply to NSF summer programs for high school students in math. I approached my math professor, or teacher, for a recommendation, and he agreed, but he told me I was unlikely to get in. I was accepted at every place I applied, and I thumbed my nose at him. In my senior year, I sat in the same teacher's class, a class of 7 girls and 2 boys. He looked at the boys and asked who wanted to major in math. Well, I was interested in majoring in math at the time, and I was acutely aware of the omission. To this day, I can still feel my anger. In college, I started in computer science late. I took my first course in my senior year. I heard about a field called natural language processing that would allow me to combine my love of language with my interest in math and my new interest in computer science. I applied to only 2 programs for graduate school, one of which happened to be the leader in natural language processing at the time, although I didn't know it, the University of Pennsylvania. When I got into both, I went to my computer science professor at Brown and asked him which program he would recommend. He told me that Penn was the more difficult school and that perhaps it would be too difficult for me. He thought the lower ranks and less difficult school would be better. I left with my mind made up. No one would tell me I couldn't compete with the best. I was going to Penn. I strive to pass on this sense of fierceness and determination to my 3 daughters and to my female students. I watched with pride as my oldest daughter decided to take on honors math in high school exactly because her junior high school teacher told her she might not be able to do it. Of course, this also means she has many times gone on to do things that we, her parents, expressly forbade her to do. Naturally, I am not always so fierce and determined. Sometimes I am certain that a mistake has been made. When I was hired at Columbia, I was sure that they would eventually realize how wrong they were. Yet now, Columbia feels as comfortable as home to me. I see the same transition in my graduate students from the time they enter to the time they graduate and become a force to be reckoned with. I remember the young woman who was sure there had been a mistake when her first paper was accepted. Her work couldn't possibly be that good, she said. I spent hours with her convincing her that indeed it was good, and we did not have to withdraw it. She went on to become very aggressive and creative in research. She's a professor at a major university today, and she most certainly believes in herself. I'm aware that I serve as a role model now for young women studying in computer science. I want them to see through my example that it's possible to be a woman and succeed in academics. It is possible to have children and get tenure. Children can appreciate a working mother. One of my daughters said to me in high school, "Mom, you have no idea how good it feels when people talk about what their mothers do, and I can say, my mom is the chair of the computer science department at Columbia University." It's possible to do things that you really enjoy doing. I love my job, and I want others to feel the same. I learned this from the female role models that stood before me, and I'd like to close by thanking them. First, most importantly, my mother. She worked as an applied mathematician when I was born in 1954, at a time when women were housewives. My father wanted her to quit to take care of me, but she threatened to leave, and that was that. She had boundless energy, and she made sure we were tough, too. Sick? I doubt it. Too tired? Never. I would also like to thank the female professors I admired when I was young, and most particularly Karen Spark-Jones, a professor from Cambridge University who took me under her wing and inspired me with her wit and determination. I thank the men who gave me the freedom I needed to succeed, my advisor and still my mentor, Arvind Joshi, my father, who always believed in me, and my husband and true source of support, David Cooper. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathleen, and congratulations.